All right. Now, the defense minister at the Shangri-La dialogue said this. He called on, of course, he was pertaining to the United States with this statement. He called on other countries to refrain from wandering in other airspaces and waters. China says they have never done that. So let's make it practical. The United States, for example, doing these joint maritime patrols, these joint drills at that time with, Canada, China considers this as already a form of trespassing, so to speak, in not so many words. What are your thoughts?
Well, look, the United States has always been very, very strong on the principle of freedom of navigation, and anywhere that international waters are, that our ships and aircraft should be able to operate. The Chinese have objected to our intelligence collection and other freedom of navigation operations around mainland Chinese waters for many years. What I think is, you know, and we're going to have a difference of opinion. And of course, the Chinese flew a balloon over the United States. So you can tell what they really think about the issue. And of course, that's going to be how they're operating in the future. I'm sure they're going to be operating near the United States, Hawaii, Alaska, et cetera. More importantly, Karen, I think, though, is the fact that Chinese claims of their territorial waters keep expanding. Of course, the Nine Dash Line is the most notorious example, and the Philippines has suffered that. But I mean, under Li Shangfu's definition, yes, China's this sort of passive and very innocent sort of actor. But the reality is that these claims keep expanding. They sort of dig up new claims. And of course, their objection to the Taiwan Strait issue is that they claim the Taiwan Strait waters as territorial waters, which tells you a lot about how they regard Taiwan. And I think that's the more important indication. And the critical thing, I think, for us all to understand is 10 years ago, this might have been a talking point, a diplomatic objection on China's part. They really couldn't do much about it. Now they have a Navy that's larger than even that of the United States, and it's growing in capability. It's growing in numbers. It's not just their Navy. It's their Air Force's space, their basing architecture. Of course, they've militarized and dramatically expanded their bases in the South China Sea. So we're dealing with a dragon, a behemoth, if you will, and we need to treat it accordingly. But I think the main thing there is that China can't claim to be an innocent and aggrieved sort of little party, and then at the same time, you know, build up its military and throw its weight around. I think the latter is the reality that we needed to deal with.
In one of the interviews you've had, is you said that China is more of a concern than Russia is.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, okay. China's 10 times the economic scale of Russia. Asia is by far the world's most important area. It's the world's largest market here in ASEAN, but of course throughout Asia, South Asia, East Asia. And of course, the Russians, if anything, have shown the limits of their power in Ukraine. I mean, which was an evil act, the invasion. Putin deserves to be condemned and so forth. But that's not the issue. The issue is China is a whole different league. And unfortunately, the United States is focusing too much. There are good things happening, and the administration, the United States government deserve credit for that. But my view is it's too little and too slow, because the Chinese, you know, look, they said again, as Secretary Austin himself said, that Xi Jinping has directed the PLA to be ready for an invasion of Taiwan by 2027. Of course, we don't know. That's not a prediction. That's not a date certain. But in the annals of history, that's a pretty strong warning. And I think we need to take it much more seriously and really, really laser focus and all work together to strengthen our position together so that we can preserve peace. That's the critical thing. Mm-hmm. The critical thing is that we need to be strong for the Chinese to respect us. I think people in the Philippines understand this instinctively. The Chinese do not respect weakness, and they will take advantage. And I think, as Renato de Castro was saying, they're responding a little bit to the administration's outreach by taking advantage. And I think we need to project strength, but also at the same time, measured strength. Sometimes voices in the United States are a little too hot and too, I would say, ideological. I think in ASEAN, that doesn't really travel very well. And I agree with the ASEAN position. But the fundamental point is from strength, we can get peace.
All right. Now, you talked about the ASEAN position. In the Shangri-La dialogue, Southeast Asian leaders, they said they were acutely concerned, of course, over the rivalry now between the U.S. and China. But the thing with ASEAN is they also won't take sides. They won't take a stand. There's a lack of conviction in many areas. As of now, we don't even have a code of conduct. So let's talk about how Asians are generally with a problem we're facing now with China, because you have many ASEAN countries that remain neutral.
Right. Well, there's a famous phrase, and I think it goes back to Ben Franklin, but it goes back, you know, united we fall, excuse me, divided we fall, united we succeed.
Yes.
And I think I of course understand the position of countries like Singapore or Thailand or Malaysia and Indonesia that want to avoid a rivalry, but I'm sorry, that's the reality. And that's not nobody's, it's the fact, you go back to Thucydides, it's the rise of China and the you know, the fear that it causes, not only in the United States, but in Japan, Taiwan, of course, the Philippines, Australia, Vietnam, India, et cetera. So this is the reality. And frankly, kind of complaining about it is not going to solve the problem. The way we're going to solve the problem is through a strong balance of power that Chinese are compelled to respect. And so I think the critical thing, and I think the Philippines and the government here deserve enormous credit, as far as I can tell, for seeing that reality and working closely with the United States to revitalize the alliance. I mean, I'm here in a sense because I really do believe our alliance is critical, and it's critical not only for the United States, but I genuinely believe for the security of the Philippines, because if the Philippines is left alone, China is so strong. I mean, nobody can, even Japan, even Australia, South Korea cannot resist China alone. So we must work together. And that's what's happening. The statement by the ministers of defense the other day, Japan, Australia, Philippines, United States, that's all great. But we need to match the words with reality and action. And that's where I'm afraid. I'm fearful that China's timeline and its meteoric, unprecedented historic, you know, military buildup is moving faster than our actions, not necessarily faster than our words, but the Chinese are, as we can see, are not as impressed by words as they are by strength.
Very good point. Very good point. I first heard of the phrase, the diplomatic phrase, the pivot to Asia, under the Obama administration. You can correct me if I'm wrong there.
No, that's right. Yeah.
Right? That's the phrase, the pivot to Asia. I've done several interviews on it. So you're a defense strategist from Obama's time to Trump's time and now Biden's time. Is the pivot any different? Has it evolved?
I think, well, yeah, I mean, the rhetoric goes back to the Obama administration. And unfortunately, it didn't really go through the formality of happening. Yeah. So, I mean, I was a supporter of the pivot at the time. It deserved applause at the time, but it just didn't happen. And so yeah. We in the Trump administration and the Defense Department and elsewhere in the White House, et cetera, we really tried to shift more towards a focus on China. I think what was vitally different between the pivot and what we were doing in the Trump administration was, I think, candidly and directly reckoning with the reality that China is a rival and in some ways an adversary. I mean, we don't need to go to conflict, yeah. God forbid, but we need to recognize a spade for a spade, as we say in the U.S. And I think that was different. And that, you know, that was a critical kind of mental shift that the Trump administration made. And I think, in fairness, the Biden administration has continued. So I think things are happening. The way I think about it, though, Karen, is we've made a lot of progress, but we're not racing against ourselves. You know, think of us like in a competitive market. If you're General Motors in the 1970s and you're making a lot of changes, if you're not meeting what Honda and Toyota are doing well enough, you're going to get blown out of the market. Or take the Chinese car companies today. You know, if you're Honda and Nissan today and you're not dealing with what the Chinese companies are doing, or our own companies or the German companies, you're not going to be successful. And I think that's the critical thing. So I definitely want to applaud the administration and, you know, Manila, Tokyo, et cetera, for the major steps they're taking. But we can't be complacent, because we're dealing, I mean, for the first time in 150 years, really 150 years, there is an economy in the world that's as large as the American economy. That is just a dramatic shift that I think people are still wrestling, certainly in the United States, are still wrestling with the magnitude of what that means and the changes that are required.
Yeah, but the United States itself has expanded its footprint in Asia in more ways than one. Of course, you have the Philippines as your treaty ally, but then the visit of Nancy Pelosi to Taiwan was such a strong statement to China. So the thing is, it seems that we will be expecting American presence in Asia, in this region, not just in a military form, but what else are you seeing?
Well, you know, I have a little bit of a different view. My view is the sort of Teddy Roosevelt one, is speak softly and carry a big stick. The problem with the visit by Speaker Pelosi and a lot of other things that are happening right now is I fear that our bark is a little more formidable than our bite. Mm-hmm. So I fear that we're, you know, we're getting ahead of ourselves in terms of the ideological and rhetorical sort of confrontation on China without fully backing it up. So, it, you know, one thing that came away, I did come away from Shangri-La, both the presentation by Li Shangfu himself, but also hearing from ASEAN countries, the Singaporeans and others, is that the Chinese appear to genuinely think that we are trying to contain and hold them down. Now, some of that is for propagandistic purposes, no doubt, but it appears to be at least somewhat a genuinely held view. This is very dangerous. I mean, if we go back to our shared history together, a tragic chapter, you know, 1941, the United States put an oil embargo on Japan without really backing it up with the military forces necessary to deter Japanese aggression. And that's a very dangerous situation. I mean, if you corner an aggressive and nasty actor, potentially like Japan in 1941, they can lash out. So my view is we should be focused mostly actually on the military piece, because that's the most important piece for deterring China. I do think political actions like what Secretary Austin was doing in the region, what we're doing with Manila, with Tokyo, those are important. But personally, my view is we should tone down some of the rhetoric and the sort of direct sort of kind of critiques of Xi Jinping, not because I like Xi Jinping. I don't hate communism and all that. But I actually want to succeed in deterring them, not in really in potentially adding fuel to the fire. And that's not to take the Chinese position, but I think we do need to kind of listen to what they're saying and their own actions and adapt accordingly.
Very interesting. Now, do you believe that these EDCA sites in the Philippines, I think there are 9 now, and 2 or 3 of them are actually facing what they say northward towards Taiwan. Do you believe this is actually flaming the fire, so to speak?
I don't. I think this is the kind of thing that is absolutely worth doing, and I hope we can expand and accelerate it, honestly. And look, I think obviously this is in America's interest, in Taiwan and Japan's interest. I think it's very much in the Philippines' interest. Look, let me put this rather directly. If there's a war over Taiwan at this point, God forbid, it will very likely be, I think, a regional war. Think more 1941-42 than a local war over Taiwan. Why? Because the Chinese appear to think that the Americans would come to Taiwan's defense. And so if they've concluded that, they will strike out much more broadly to get the best position they possibly can, the best chance. They don't want to end up like Putin in Ukraine if they go for this, which is to have failed early on and then be caught in this quicksand. That would be a disaster for them. If that's the case, that means that if they're successful, they could attack U.S. forces throughout the region, including in Japan, including U.S. territory like Guam. That if they're successful, that would mean the defeat of U.S. forces in the Western Pacific. That would leave the Philippines extremely vulnerable, right? Mm-hmm. So a war over Taiwan is going also to be, I think, almost an existential war, not only for the Philippines, but for Japan, South Korea, and others. And I think some governments like Japan and certainly Australia appear to have recognized this. That's why I think it makes more sense, if I were Filipino, I would advise, you know, don't be kind of half pregnant, right? Really work with the Americans, because the best thing is to deter this conflict by demonstrating to China that they can't succeed. The worst outcome is for the Chinese to think, hey, I can get away with this. And then if they defeat the American military, they can, you know, piecemeal, getting back to that divided we fall thing. Well, if the American military has been pushed out of the first and second island chain, well, then, you know, I can sail my aircraft carriers, whatever. They might not be as good as the American aircraft carriers, but the American aircraft carriers are now out in San Diego. Right. I mean, they're better than the Philippines ships, probably, and they're better than Indonesia ships. They're better than Vietnam ships. That's the situation that would happen. So I think we're all better off kind of pulling together and being as strong as possible from a military perspective.
But then that's looking at it from one point of view. I wanted to talk to you just very quickly about critics.
Okay.
There have been some lawmakers who also pointed out that these EDCA sites put the Philippines in a situation where if war does erupt, as you say, God forbid, the Philippines is in the middle of all this. Number one, that the country could be attacked in some way, one way or another. But this is all hypothetical, right? We're talking about something that may not happen. But then there's also the other issues when it comes to trade, tourism, China being our biggest neighbor and our biggest market. So where does the Philippines put itself, considering right now its relationship with the U.S. is stronger than ever, if not is at its strongest?
Well, I think on the first point, I think it's very important for Filipinos to be really clear in your own head. You are too important to ignore. You can't, and Taiwan, it's the same dynamic. You cannot afford to stick your head in the sand, because you're not New Zealand. You're not at the end of the world. You're not Pitcairn Island, right? You are too important. There's a famous phrase from Trotsky: you might not be interested in the revolution, but the revolution is interested in you. In the same way, you might not be interested in the rivalry with China, but China will be interested in you. So I think you cannot hope. You know, you're just in the center. Your geography is essential. It's a very important economy. In that context, it really the safest place is to be secure and on one side. And I think that that's really important to your second point, Karen, because with a militarily strong position, we do not need to forfeit all the commerce with China. I mean, U.S.-China trade is at an all-time high. Personally, I think they're decoupling in a lot of ways makes sense for us. You'll make your own decision. But the Chinese need trading partners, too. They are not going to shut us all off. But if we're in a position where they don't think they can be militarily aggressive and succeed, we can work out the terms of trade. I don't have a problem. I don't think we need to fully decouple. And I think that's true for the Philippines as well. But the critical predicate is to be strong.
All right. I want to thank you for joining me on Head Start today, sir. Actually, I've learned a lot from you today. All right. Thank you so much. The former U.S. Deputy Assistant Secretary for Defense and Strategy and Force Development, Elbridge Colby. I do hope to see you again, sir. You take care.
I'd welcome that. Thank you.